I want to talk about the ways in which we're thinking about the impacts of technology in a different sector, just to start things off, namely healthcare. So we know that what's coming is the ability to have home healthcare robots, to have surgical robots, to have artificial intelligence that can help doctors. And there have been any number of analyses, including many done at Carnegie Mellon, about the likely workforce implications of these coming robots and AI systems. But I want to ask you to think about something slightly different. I want you to think about if it were your parent or your partner who might be experiencing cognitive difficulties. When are you going to trust one of these machines to help care for them? How is introducing one of these machines into the home going to change the ability of your loved one to realize their own identity, to realize their own autonomy, to be able to continue to live the life that they were able to lead before they might have started to experience the cognitive or physical decline? Now, these are hard questions to ask. These are deeply ethical questions, and many of them revolve around notions of trust. And so we've been working over the last 5 to 7 years really to think about how we come to trust technology and how technological changes can alter the relations of trust that we have with one another. Now, this is the kind of challenge that arises for all of us. If you own a company, you have to worry about when your employees will trust technology, when your clients will trust the technology that you're using, how your technologies are changing the relationships between people in the society around you. If you are in the process of building the technology, you have to think about how can we really engage with our clients and with our users and with the broader society in order to ensure that we aren't doing damage to these central relations of trust. Of course, it's a hard challenge. It would be nice if we could quantify it with a nice little scale, but we can't. Trust turns out to be this deeply multidimensional and multidisciplinary problem that we need to be bringing all of the different tools to bear. I mean, as I often like to say, we often think that trust is just about reliability and predictability. But of course, I trust my wife far more than I trust my car, and I guarantee you I can predict my car a lot better than I can predict my wife, who's thankfully not here. Now, my teenage daughter, that's a whole other story. We won't go down that road. And so what we're working on also is how do we build trust? Not just how do we analyze and understand it, but how can we help the technologists to do a better job of creating trust through the technologies? How do we not just have it be the negative impacts that are often discussed with technology, but also leverage the positive impacts, the possibilities that come up with technology? Many of these questions ultimately turn on when we think it's important for a human to be in the loop. For example, there's now quite a lot of debate about the possibility of autonomous weapons systems. And so several of us have worked with the United Nations to try and develop policies and frameworks for thinking about the context in which, in fact, we want to ensure that a human is ultimately making a decision, especially when it comes to the exercise of lethal force. Now, as Krishnan mentioned, one of the real challenges in a lot of this is that we tend to think of algorithms as these objective things. We can trust an algorithm. We can trust the data. But we've got ample evidence over the last few years of the ways in which, in fact, our algorithms are not necessarily trustworthy. That, in fact, they can undermine trust, both in other members of society and in the companies deploying the technologies. In fact, even something as simple as the Uber car, which you might think is not an issue in terms of trust, you know, what's the trust issue here? What's the bias issue? Well, it has to decide. Is it going to follow the speed limit, or is it going to drive as safely as possible? Because those two values can come into tension with one another. Sometimes the safest way to drive is to go faster than the speed limit. If you're wondering, it's when everyone else is around you is speeding, you should speed also. Don't try that with the policeman. Doesn't work. And so these are value choices that are being made in the development of technology. Value choices that we have to be willing to engage with, whether we're developers, whether we're policymakers, whether we're ethicists, whether we're just members of society. We have to be willing to ask, what are our values? What are the things we care about? And how do we get technology to realize those personal, social, community values? And one of the things that's truly amazing about Carnegie Mellon is that we have people like Lee, who are working on the quantifiable impacts of technology. We have people like Amy, who is building the next generation of technology. And we have people in across all seven colleges who are worried about these sorts of what you might think of as the non-quantifiable impacts, the things that get at the nature of our humanity, our identity, our communities.